Andrew, what is this object?
That is the $40 million question, Brad. Astronomers are pointing the biggest telescopes we have on the ground and in orbit, including the Hubble, all working towards trying to figure out what this 400-meter-wide object that is careening through our inner solar system right now, really what it is.
Scientists, they're pointing their telescopes at what could be the first observable object from outside our solar system. It passed by Earth last week.
And NASA's not quite sure what it is. Experts say it's less than a quarter mile in diameter and is traveling at more than 15 miles per second. The strange behavior of this object doesn't match any typical orbit, making NASA think it's not local.
It could be a comet. It could be an asteroid. Even NASA isn't sure what it is or where it came from.
Astronomers recently announced a new discovery, a mysterious signal from a galaxy 3 billion light years away. This intense burst of radio waves was one of dozens of similar signals, totally random and totally unexplained.
Under a solid West Virginia sky, this radio telescope searches the universe. It's untroubled by the clouds because what it sees are radio waves falling all around us like the rain.
There's a whole invisible universe out there that we can't see with our eyes.
The visible light's a very, very small part of what astronomers look at. And I think that's something that's often not appreciated. Whatever FRBs are, it's something really cool. It's a new phenomena, and it's a phenomena that will certainly teach us more about the universe.
Physicists believe that when time began, at the moment of the Big Bang, matter and antimatter were created in equal amounts. And based on recent measurements made at CERN Laboratory in Switzerland, it seems there is perfect symmetry between the two, which they say implies that our universe should not exist. What? Okay.
So physicists say by rights we shouldn't exist. This means that at the instant of the Big Bang, there was a slight overabundance of matter over antimatter,
I
and
see.
Here we are.
I see.
As a consequence.
All right.
Now, why? This is one of the greatest mysteries in all of physics. We are clueless to understand why. And like I said, if you want to win a Nobel Prize, figure this one out. Why was there's a slight overabundance of matter over antimatter?
Yeah.
And so that's the mystery. Why do we exist at all? By rights, we shouldn't be here.
Yeah.
By rights, we should have been disintegrated at the instant of the Big Bang.
Yeah.
Exactly. So they did this brilliant thing. So the stories in the book is about how, and this was really news to me, I hadn't realized that we kind of think of ourselves as very special, you know, Homo sapiens, we think of ourselves as being really extraordinary, you know, we are intelligent, it began with the, domestication of animals and farming, and then we built civilizations, and then we discovered language, and you know, we have this story that we tell ourselves where we are completely unique on the planet. And it's really, really interesting to discover that all those traits are there in other species. Start talking about, you very quickly get onto what makes life so special. We very quickly got onto even spiritual subjects. What does it all mean? What are we here for? And you start to form this picture of it starts to become very, very interesting. See our own privilege, very lucky position as being more of an accident really than a kind of a vital last step in a long chain of progressive evolution. Yeah. It's really interesting.
All right, so that's it. Well, what is it about this symmetry between matter and antimatter that, you know, leads CERN's physicists to this conclusion that we shouldn't exist, the universe shouldn't exist?
Well, at the instant of the Big Bang, there should have been equal quantities of matter and antimatter, which annihilated, driving the Big Bang.
Mm-hmm.
So, by rights, we shouldn't be here.
Right.
Because we have more matter than antimatter in our sector of the galaxy. We've
okay.
looked for anti-galaxies. We've looked for anti-planets. We don't see any.
It's happening. And it all leads back to here.
So right now, nobody has a convincing answer to this question, why should we be here?
Wow.
Do you think that we're going to end up finding like alien life within our lifetime?
I think so. And yeah. The reason is technology. You know, when Frank Drake did his first search in 1960, he could look at only one frequency. Now you use something like the SETI Institute's Allen Telescope Array, you can look at billions of different frequencies. My hunch is in the next decade or two, we'll detect extraterrestrials if they're out there and trying to make contact.
My name is Seth, you know that. That's almost SETI, that's where I work. The search for extraterrestrial intelligence. So we're looking for aliens, we're looking for life in space, but we're looking for the intelligent variety of life in space.
Ben, you've written a book.
I have.
It's very good, I finished it last night. It's about the search for extraterrestrial life.
Yes.
What that might look like.
Yes.
And how we might go about finding it.
Exactly.
Our galaxy, this is our galaxy. You'll never see this from downtown Copenhagen, but that's it. In our galaxy, there are a couple of hundred billion stars, but there are a trillion planets. Okay, that's something we've only learned in the last 5 years. That's a lot of planets. And by the way, if that galaxy isn't good enough for you, we can see a trillion other galaxies, each with a trillion planets. The bottom line is, there are as many planets out there in the part of the universe we can see as there are grains of sand on all the beaches of the Earth.
Came across a brilliant book by Erwin Schrödinger called What is Life? Which talked about, really about how does life fit in with the second law of thermodynamics, you know. Also, I just think aliens is a funny topic. There's something naturally amusing about it. Sometimes intentionally, sometimes unintentionally.
And that's the thing.
Very bright at the highest radio frequencies that we can detect, but then it kind of fades away.
The fast radio bursts seem to be a one-off, random blasts of very strong energy, not a series of controlled signals. So, no aliens?
You know, that would be a fantastic discovery if it ended up being the case. Although, like I said, I think most astronomers do not favor that particular interpretation. That's because we don't actually know what they are at their origin.
That's right. It's a total mystery.
It's the first time humans are seeing an object from outside of the solar system traveling through our local neighborhood of planets. And it's a fleeting moment too, Brad, because it's traveling at amazing speeds of over 150,000 kilometers per hour. And we're only going to have a few days to really point our telescopes to it before it gets too far and too faint from Earth to be able to examine it any further. So they're racing to trying to identify it and figure out where it's going and where it came from. But the idea is it's from somewhere deep from the Milky Way galaxy, and it was drawn in by the gravity of our sun.
So Andrew, most of these objects, you say this is an interstellar object. So in other words, this comes from outside our galaxy, right?
Well, it's coming from outside of our solar system.
Outside our solar system, right.
Within the Milky Way galaxy, which of course we're a part of. The sun is one of 100 billion other suns. Because this is such a once-in-a-lifetime kind of thing. It's something that we theorized we would one day be able to see, but now it came to pass, so this is a really lucky time for astronomers.
According to science, none of us should be here. Actually, nothing should be anywhere. New research suggests that, based on the standard model of physics,
Seth, are we alone?
Well, we don't know the answer to that. It's remarkable, but despite the abundant evidence of extraterrestrial visitors that you'll find on the television just about every night or in the local movie theaters, We still don't know about any life beyond Earth. There's no compelling evidence for any life beyond Earth, and not just intelligent life, but even very microscopic life. We're alone at the moment as far as we know, but I doubt that we're really alone.
To hope to encounter a signal. The great news is the whole process is speeding up so much that will happen in our lifetimes. Everyone here in this room will get to that point. We will know pretty much whether there's intelligent life on the next, say, 10 million, 100 million stars within our lifetimes.
There are potentially hundreds of thousands of habitable planets in our galaxy alone. So it's tough to say if we are in fact actually alone. But if we're not, Oxford scientists say they have taken a small step to figuring out what our neighbors might look like. Sam Levin, an Oxford researcher, recently told Phys.org that aliens are potentially shaped by the same processes and mechanisms that shaped humans, such as natural selection. Because of that, Levin explains, there is a level of predictability that would cause them to look like us. The new theory was detailed in a new study published in the International Journal of Astrobiology from the University.
Okay, finally here. When do we find them? Now, this is Frank Drake. He was the guy who did the first SETI experiment. I took this picture a number of years ago, but Frank looks the same. He's 86 now. And I've seen photos of him when he was 17 and he looked the same. So, now, when I first came to the Institute, Frank, I knew I was at some venue or other, and Frank was there, and people would come up to him and ask, so Frank, when are we gonna find the aliens? And I thought Frank was gonna say, who knows, nobody knows, which is true. But he didn't say that. He said, well, it's gonna be years and then we'll find them. I don't know, remember the number, but then I listened to some of my other colleagues and they all had a number. So I plotted up these numbers and it turned out they correlated very well with the number of years until they were going to retire. So I figured there was something to it. But I'm gonna give you my number. This is just a plot of some index of how fast our SETI experiments are. Now for the three of you who are still conscious, you may notice this is a semi-log plot, which means this is going up exponentially. In fact, the speed is going up following what's called Moore's Law, which is very important where I live in the Silicon Valley. That's the fact that every 18 months, the speed of computers at any given price point doubles. But that has big benefits for SETI because a lot of the speed of our search depends strictly on digital processing, computers. Okay? So that's how fast we're going through the hay, and that'll continue for, you know, at least another 10 or 20 years. Whoops.